To maintain a horrific atmosphere, you should begin with the proper environment. A dark, quiet place will work best. You will need light enough to read by, but little more. You may wish for some mood music. Try to avoid anything with obtrusive lyrics, keep the volume low, and make sure you bring enough to avoid it becoming repetitive.
As I've gotten older, my nightmares have gotten worse. Sometimes I wake up unable to move from the fear that there's something standing in my slightly open closet. Without my glasses, my eyes trick the image of a tall man standing amongst the button-ups and the mess. And of course I have to pee. When I get the courage to leave my bed, I don't turn the bathroom light on, because having that little bit of safety makes it harder to leave, to begin that terror-filled dash back to the bedroom, keeping my back to the door as I shut it, afraid of what will be staring at me if I turn around to look down the hall. I made a short film about this in college. It's kind of garbage, but there's this moment that captures the fear I felt on those bathroom runs back when I was a kid living at my parents' house. Me up. Hereditary is a horror film directed by Ari Aster. It's got a plot and scares and twists and turns. You know what a movie is. But what's important is that it's got this scene right near the beginning, and it speaks to that part of me. That almost primal part. The one that knows only safety and fear. The part built on the anxieties of what lurks in the dark. I'm stopping here as a sort of content warning. This video is about horror. The things that scare me. I am going to unpause the video and show you this scene from Hereditary. I just want you to know there is nothing wrong with taking your headphones off and closing your eyes, okay? I believe Ari Aster understands terror, true terror, and this scene captures the essence of that horror, of the unknown. There's a dark space where anything could exist, and you think you see something there, and then you're sure you see something there. It's there, and it shouldn't be, and oh my God, why is it there? But then she flips the light on, and it was nothing. There's this exhale, a release.
In order to create dread, you must be able to balance that sickening cold swimming in your gut with the glimmering chance of survival lying just at the tip of your outstretched fingers. Every significant action in dread is resolved through a metaphor of this balance, even if the elements of horror and hope have not yet shown themselves in the story. This is accomplished through the tower.
Faith Chapter 1 is built on this feeling of moments and the space between them. It's an empty game made up of an empty forest, an empty graveyard, and an empty house. It's built on silence and walking. It's built on the back of that animal in your head that looks into the darkness of your closet at night and swears there's a man standing there watching you. There's this moment in the game, in the basement of the house, where all sound cuts out, and you, the priest, are alone in a room with a bunch of sheet-covered mannequins. All of the tension built up from the game, even the quick little frights, leave you anxious. As Aaron Signal points out in their analysis, a horror movie moment is threatening to jump out at you at any moment, and you're just waiting. Looking at a game like this, though, it can be hard to imagine it evoking any fear. The graphics look old and dated, possibly even goofy. But the fear really has nothing to do with the graphics and everything to do with the feeling. Or the graphics actually aid in the feeling. They aid in the tension because your mind, instead of seeing a realistic image, is left to fill in the gaps left by the art. You don't know. Therefore, you must imagine. But it's still in the moments where the game understands terror. It's not enough to tease. It's not enough to think you see something in the shadows. You must glimpse it, at the very least, to be fully confronted with the unknown.
She is here.
Fuck me. These moments are made of hands that grab your face and stare you straight into something you don't quite understand. It pries open your eyes to let the terror pour into you. All of that adrenaline. Fight or flight, such a basic reaction to what might be the simplest and easiest feeling to understand. The game highlights its understanding of the capital M moment with this shift in graphics. The earlier parts of the game let your mind wander into those dark corridors to dream up what might be lurking. Then it changes in these moments to show you what is in fact lurking there in interesting, visceral detail. And it shakes you. It shows you something unknowable.
Pulling. You must use one hand at a time, though you may switch hands at any time. The block being pulled must be from beneath the topmost complete layer. After it is pulled, the block must be placed atop the tower. Place it within the topmost layer if it is incomplete. After placing the block on top, wait a few moments to see if the tower will collapse.
Random trivia time. If you took the sci-fi horror movie Alien and cut out just the bits with the titular alien, how many minutes of footage would you have? For context, the movie is 1 hour and 57 minutes long. I'll give you a moment to think about it while I check my Twitter. About 4 minutes. The title of the movie, Alien. And why do you think they only show it for 4 minutes? It's the movie that birthed the xenomorph and turned it into an icon, but it's only given less than 5 minutes of screen time. Now, I showed that Evangelion clip earlier for two reasons. One, because the crawling creature in Faith and Unit 01 are in love, obviously. And two, because of the reactions. The people in that scene are confronted with absolute horror, terror, and then they are left to react to it. It's the same thing that happens in Faith. The terror is rendered in much more detail than the other portions of the game, and exists in a short window of time. You're given just enough to register fear, and that's it. Then it pulls back and asks you to react, to raise the cross. Tension, fear, reaction. 4 minutes of film given to the alien. And what are the other 1 hour and 53 minutes of footage given to? The crew and their reactions. The film acts as an arbiter for their fictional fear, using the camera to carry that from the fiction into your imagination, making it as good as real for you. You are filled with adrenaline. You're feeling it. You're imagining, what would I do in this scenario? And thus, you're reacting to the fear.
As the tower gets weaker, the more time it will take for each pull. This is a wonderful thing. When the tower is rickety, it stops the action and demands everyone's attention.
The philosopher Henderson Bombersnatch once said, "A lower resolution format can increase the emotion of a scene." Now, he was talking about horror movies on VHS, but I can't help but feel the same thing is true about Faith. The less you are shown, the more your brain has to work, ratcheting up that tension. So, what can be said about Dread? Dread is a tabletop role-playing game. It eschews the use of dice and their random probability to use something both physically tense and entirely driven by your actions at the table. All you see, all that's rendered, is a Jenga tower and the audio of the host's narration. The game functions around the host laying out the scene and the players doing things in reaction to that. Whenever they want to do something risky, or sometimes just because they want to, they have to pull a block from the tower. If Faith's crawling monster is inherently more terrifying than Unit 1, because there's less information for your brain to latch onto, then it stands that a better form of horror, or at least a form that lets your mind do more of the work, fill in the most blanks, would be a tabletop role-playing game. The tension in Dread is impossible to ignore. You're confronted with it all the time. You are watching the structure decay with each of your actions. It's like a fuse burning down, whisking away, until...
I can hold on to it.
Uh-huh.
It is so shaky.
You look quickly to your right, and sort of then back down to your left, and you see that there's actually a pretty decent sized piece of pine wood that, as it turns out, is kind of the same size and weight and shape of like maybe like a baseball bat, and you reach down and you pick it up.
Where a film might try to jump scare you, Faith holds your face to the horror, and Dread asks you to hold it, to handle it. It is a rule of the game that the pull must represent something. And so every moment of tension is just that, a capital M moment. There is horror in there. Whereas a jump scare, on the other hand, represents nothing. It gives the illusion of a moment. It makes you think of horror, In a lot of ways, a jump scare is no different than my nightmares, or that first clip from Hereditary. When the light's off, sure, I feel the adrenaline. I fear something could happen. But as soon as I flick that light on, there's nothing. There's no horror. It's just tension. It lacks the rest. And where I think the tabletop role-playing game is able to make this more effective is in its handling. Like, literally, you handled the Jenga tower. You, at the moment of a pull, are in that tension and wondering if it will fall. But unlike a movie, or even a video game, you can't be sure if this will just be a jump scare. If this moment will only be tension. One wrong move and you could knock the whole thing over. The uncertainty exists within a physical object in the real world, and that's not something you can get from other media. I'd never say that neither of these things could be horror, but what I am saying is that where a film or a game is paced to produce exactly what it was made to produce, a tabletop role-playing game isn't, can't, and could not be that. It's in your hands. Every moment could be the last. Every moment of tension might lead to horror. Why am I so fascinated by this? I'm sitting here editing this, and I can't help but ask, why? I've been feeling a lot of anxiety lately. I think we all are. I read once in a Stephen King book that the reason why he thinks his horror is so effective is that societies like our society, they have national pressure points that revolve around politics, economics, social changes, race, and identity. And that in each of these points are societal horrors, things that our culture shares.
They are trying to tell us that more police are needed to address intercommunal violence?
He wrote Salem's Lot about the horror of a small town. The Shining about the horrors of masculinity and its toxicity. And you can same. And you can see the same societal horror in the impact of George Romero's Dawn of the Dead, the horrors of consumerism. I've been feeling a lot of fear lately. I think we all are. I don't think dread is enough. I mean, what does this tower represent? I'm just pulling blocks to watch it fall. It's got the tension and the fear, but it's lacking the reaction. It's lacking that universal thing. The societal horror. I mean, we all just laugh whenever the tower falls over and say, "Damn, I really thought I had that one." And then we just rebuild it for the next pull. You know, there's something missing there too. After that reaction, there's something missing. In Alien, Ripley hides from the alien, faces it, and fights. But then she destroys it. She launches it out of the airlock and into the reaches of space. in Evangelion. And even in Faith, there's this epilogue with the newspaper that shows you the aftermath of your choice. Earlier this year, a few months ago to be exact, Chris Bissett wrote and released The Wretched. In it, you play as a Ripley-esque character. Only after launching this alien creature from the airlock, it comes back. The tower now is our ship. It's in disrepair. The deck of cards are our daily activities. We roll a six-sided die and draw that many cards. Usually, you'll also pull that many blocks from the tower. Our ship is eroding. The alien is threatening to get back in. You're isolated. Alone. The Wretched asks you to play this game alone. I've been feeling a lot of fear lately. Jocelyn McDonald, a cognitive behavioral therapist at Northwestern University, says, "Our bodies prepare for danger by going into flight or fight modes, which can include heavy breathing and increase in heart rate." She goes on to say that horror media can have the same effect. So the act of playing Faith or watching Hereditary or drawing some cards, it can induce that fight or flight moment in your brain. You're choosing to put your body into that state, and it focuses your mind on the present, on a situation that's other, on something outside of what's going on to you or around you. It doesn't let you lean into your anxiety or dwell on the future or the past. In a way, it's almost therapeutic.
Effective horror is the delicate application of pressure until, without quite realizing it, you're caught in a vice. The repetition acts as a trance, each step wearing away at reality as you spiral further away from the known world. Jenna Stober.
The art of horror, then, is entering into another world where our anxieties are not only justified by what we are seeing on the screen, because they are real now, they have something to latch onto, but they are also put into a greater context. You're seeing or imagining things that could happen to you, like the isolation of the wretched, but also things that couldn't happen to you, like being trapped on a decaying ship in the astral sea while an alien stalks you for sport. You get to feel these real anxieties on your own watch and step away when you see fit. Jenna Stober goes on to say that it's like a hyperbaric chamber, which in itself is a form of healing. We can't feel that rush of adrenaline forever. It is inevitable that fight or flight will drop away. Our hearts will return to the status quo. But in our everyday, especially if you struggle with anxiety, it can be hard to believe that. So stepping into this other world, this hyperbaric chamber, gives us the opportunity to take control, feel those feelings, and let our bodies fall back into a more calm state. I've been feeling a lot of anxiety lately. I think we're in one of these moments. The Wretched was birthed from this moment. The entire game, you're trying to repair your ship enough to just get a distress beacon out, or give the engines a little juice. At the end of the game, it tells you to take a moment and breathe. Something that nothing else talked about in this video has done. It has that final, most crucial step to horror. The come down. Tension. Fear. Reaction. And release. Take a moment. Breathe, it says. There was never any hope of you repairing the ship. No matter how many tasks you completed, the engines were never going to fire again. The best you could do was to survive for long enough for help to come. And even that was unlikely. You were doomed from the start. And somewhere inside you, you knew this. Even as you were desperately clinging on to hope. God, that's bleak and relatable. I don't know about you, but sometimes recently the present can feel like this. Like hope is hopeless. But even though the game tells you that everything is meaningless, that your actions are pointless, I don't think it believes itself. It goes on. You may not have survived, but the log of your final days lives on. What becomes of it now? Will it be found by a salvage ship, much like yours, to serve as a warning for those intending to brave the cold depths of space? Did you pass it on to your rescuers? A chronicle of what you went through? Or is it lost forever? Adrift in the black where nobody will hear your words again. When you close this book, put down this game. What will become of all you have done here? Take a moment. Breathe. The winner of the giveaway from last week is Cole Niblett. I put all your names into a spreadsheet. I randomized it, and then I rolled a dice here in Discord to get that name. So Cole, if you could reach out to us, reach out to me either on YouTube or Twitter, we can get that sent over to you. This week there isn't a giveaway, but if you want to head over to Twitter, there should be a poll there that'll have a couple different video ideas and asking you which one you would rather see. So go ahead and head over there and vote. The link is down in the description.